can't stop us from turning out. The people all the way back there don't stomp on small children. There's so many people here. I was like messing around on the overall pager, and nobody heard me. And I was like,
whoever parked a green wizard in the back of the store, with just Antipoparadian, please move it.
And nobody heard it. I also was like, any warlocks in the house?
I don't know, it's kind of cool though. I did it too. Hello, Hello. Greetings. Welcome to our planet. Oh, it's getting better.
Okay.
Oh, it's because I'm holding it too close.
Oh, that's better now.
I don't really need to do an intro, but I guess I feel like I have to.
I assume it.
Fire on the list of technological advances by mankind. One of the most interesting places this thread of our story takes us is the world of massively multiplayer online role-playing games, a realm which remains shadowy to the non-playing world despite the fact it's now a multi-billion dollar industry. She made comedy out of her own addiction to them in her internet show The Guild, which was which was set in the world of MMO gaming and started the day as a player who gets caught up in the weird politics of the game, both online and in real life. The affectionate tone of the satire was captured in the music video, Do You Wanna Date My Avatar? Which featured actors from the Guild and quickly went viral in 2009. You're Never Weird on the Internet Almost is all around internet positive and clearly written not just for geeks, but also anyone who wants a window into that world. So maybe sometimes you are weird on the internet, but Dave's point is it can be liberating and exciting, and you might even make a career out of it. The ultimate message, she says, is to embrace your weirdness. Woo! Woo! All right. Did it work yet?
Nope.
Okay, then I'm good.
Oh my god!
we're gonna have to send Jason in there, I think. Okay, so I'm gonna ask a question to the cameras. All right, so these are questions from the audience, and we're gonna start with, what made you decide to write a book?
Wow, that's a good basic question. Whoever asked that, bravo. I decided to write a book because the last couple of years I've been doing a lot of speeches and a lot of presentations to like studio people, like advertisers, to like, hey, help me make my company. And also to people like at universities and, you know, conventions. And I think when I saw people respond to it in positive ways and have people come up to me and say, hey, I started a web series because of you, or I'm proud to say I'm a gamer because of you, I felt like, well, that might be worth putting down on paper. and then I wanted to, you know, tell funny stories about my childhood and, you know, my awkwardness, because the more I talk about my awkwardness, the more I feel better about myself. Because we're not alone, because all of us are awkward a little bit. I hope. Please tell me. Here.
All right, so this next question I think is appropriate because you don't talk about it so much in the book, but what was it like to be on the set of Supernatural?
That's a really good question. Because a lot of people ask me, what was it like to work with Jensen and Jared, and they're the two most kind, handsome people. It's kind of hard. There's nothing. They're tall, burly, handsome, unearthly handsome men. I don't know what else I could say about it. They smell amazing, like great show, and you know, that job, I got to do that show for 4 seasons, and it was only 51 episodes, which is great. People love to keep me around, and then just, you know, no, it's all good. It's all a compliment, because the fact that they wanted to bring me back is amazing. And that role in particular was like the quintessential girl who happens to be geeky and isn't defined by that cliche about, you know, she isn't the cliche of that, which I appreciate, because a lot of times on TV, people write to the cliches. And Charlie is a real girl, and she seemed to resonate a lot with people, and that really was a gift for me to play. So, also, Jensen and Jared are really good huggers. So, if you want that little detail, gentlemen, huggers, tall, smelling like spices. There you go.
Okay, so that makes me move another question up. Based on what you just said, what advice do you give to teen girls who don't fit in with the popular crowd? We were just talking about cliche.
Yeah, that's a good question. You know, I wrote this book because I want anybody who feels like they're odd or don't belong somewhere to have it the strength in them, inside themselves to feel like they belong or be proactive in seeking belonging versus let's take away all the interesting things about me so I can fit in. Because that's like, I think it's almost that kind of conformity is a kind of bullying in a sense, because we are the only people who are us on this planet, and we have so many things that we get rid of because of our outward appearances or other people saying, hey, girls don't like this, or this is the way you're likable, and this is the way that boys will like you, and you start to give pieces of yourself up in order to fit some kind of weird average that really doesn't do you or anybody else around you any good. So I would say, you know, put concrete on your feet and be as weird as you can, and the right people will be in your life to support you, and rather than trying to clamor for something that you actually won't like in the end anyway, because you're not yourself.
I have a feeling you knew this question was coming. Can you provide any information about a sequel to Dr. Horrible Sing Along? Woo! The person who asked this says, I dorkily, obsessively, half period, two period, no exclamation mark.
Also in the back, it has, pick me Purdy, please. Well, and this person says, smiley face. Oh, it's Ms. Stone, signed Ms. Stone, sorry. I have no information on a sequel, and please don't blog that I just announced the sequel, because that's inaccurate. It happens. That was one of the best roles I've ever played, was Penny and Dr. Horrible, and it's such a seminal, awesome turning point in web content. Yeah, it might be quick, and it might just pay the bills a little bit. Everybody does have to pay the bills, but in the end, the thing that will be your legacy, whether just through your own happiness or something that you create that's original, that requires your really embracing your individuality and going after it and creating without permission. So thank you for no sequel yet, but that the spirit of that hopefully will be a sequel going on in years to come with everybody.
Answer this question though, then. Which of your characters do you wish had their own spin-off show?
I was in Bring It On Again. So that's the DVD sequel for Bring It On. I know you all saw it. And I played a cheerleader who was healed. She was an angry ballerina cheerleader who was healed by cheer. So I feel like that could be a whole show. You know, I would have to say the funnest to be probably on a weekly basis would be Charlie from Supernatural, yeah. In that she's really capable of defending herself with like weapons and she could hack anything, which I would in real life I would love to be able to hack things. I mean, I've always kind of deified like, ooh, wow, like on the TV, you know, when you see hackers in movies and stuff, they're like, whoa, they opened that door with a computer. Why can't I do that?
Like watching the actual movie Hackers. And you're like, oh, that seemed cool 20 years ago. So this is what I thought was one of the most interesting parts of your book. You talk about internet shaming at the end of your book. And with all the potential for open discussion and free thinking, why do you think negativity has become the dominant norm on the internet, I suppose, and what can we do to change that?
I don't know if it's the dominant norm. I think that really most of us just want to hang out and be not douchebags. But, but I think that there is a reputation because when you see, I talk about this a lot in my book, where you see something negative and it actually is like ding, ding, ding in your brain because it's dangerous. It makes you feel shame or it makes you feel vulnerable or it touches on something that you're self-conscious about. And unfortunately, I think that, a lot of people are unhappy or they're young and they just don't know how to behave and the environment that they're hanging out with in online tells them, hey, it's cool to be a dick. Sorry, children. Yeah. It's an anatomical term, guys. So I think the best way to combat it, because I have to encounter a lot of negativity and a lot of people saying really negative things about me even today, I see it all the time. And the best thing is to, just like in your real life, shut the door on them. And the best way that we could combat it as a community is to lock hands and step forward together, knowing that if you stand up to someone who is being negative, that you have the support of other people around you because you're as proactively positive as they are proactively negative. And, it requires a lot of bravery and standing up for yourself, but in the face of somebody being confident and saying, hey, this is me, and you're actually, that's incorrect, a lot of times people will back down. They're kind of cowardly because when you start to call them on it, they actually they can't stand up for it because they're really kind of acting out of unhappiness. So imagine giving them a hug and then wash yourself off. And I know that there's so many people on the internet who want to create community that make you feel safe and awesome. So yeah, punch.
What do you think some top games are right now? I'm getting about to get really, really nerdy. Here we go. The top games are right now in the field of MMORPGs. And where do you think the field is headed?
I don't know. MMOs have kind of like dipped in popularity, I think, because of a variety of things in that they're just, they're really hard to make good, I think. You see a lot of them, you start out and you're like, oh, this looks pretty fun, and you get in there and it's just not a sense of the ease of connecting with people. Because I think that's the appeal of MMOs. And like to me, like things like Hearthstone and Heroes of the Storm and unfortunately, League of Legends and Dota, like that seems to create, I don't know, the League of Legends and Dota are not the most positive environment. I'm not to knock them, but like especially for online play, I think those are kind of dominating the discussion now, and I'm excited to get back to that more story driven RPG world, because to me that's where you log on. My whole book is a love letter to MMOs. Even though I got addicted to them, I love them. I love logging on and saying, hey, what's up? It's like going to a bar without having to go out of your house, which I love. So I kind of hope that there's a resurgence in that in the next generation. I would be number one. Final Fantasy 14 is pretty good. Like that's a pretty good game, and I've been playing that a little bit with some of the people online. So mostly it's like Steam, I guess. I love Steam games now, and the community on Steam. Yeah, and all the indie games, because you can celebrate so many different like voices. You don't have to be like, I just logged 1,000 hours in the game. No, that's probably not good. I've done it, it's okay.
How do you feel, now this, I want you to know that this question has a unicorn, so I don't know if it's, yeah, we have to ask it. How do you feel about fans who feel like they know you personally, especially after writing your memoir?
I think that's cool. I wish I was I had enough time to spend, because all the people who like my work were people I would definitely want to hang out with. I don't have enough humanity to be able to do that with everybody who likes what I do, but I am heartened by the fact that, especially in the community that is around, my company and then the guild and everything I do, and the families of Supernatural and Buffy, like, if I saw somebody on the street with a t-shirt, I'd be like, oh my god, I want to talk to that person. It's like an endorsement of cool to me. So, that's the biggest compliment. And you know, the reason why I wrote the book, and I'm very honest about things that I go through, like depression, anxiety, you know, addiction, all those things, like, humanize me in a way that if you see me as a human. And like anybody you see in any field that you deify, like I'm sure Taylor Swift has like cramps in, you know, feels like she has it off day, right? Or she's going through second, you know, she really second guesses herself or is frustrated because of all the pressure on her. Like every single person who's doing anything is a human just like you. And that will make it not only attainable for you to dream as high as you want to dream or do what you want to do, but also sympathize when someone is not 100% in any field. So we're all just humans, we're the same people. We're, I don't know, here, take this away now.
I really love the text that you put on fans and how you talked about that. Because everyone, I think, maybe expected that you'd be talking about everyone coming up to you, and you were talking about all the people that you met, you're like, oh my God, this is the most amazing person. Like, you were the fan, and you're welcome. Okay, last question, this is a really quick one, I'm sure, but it's written so adorably, I have to ask it. If Lyra was in real life, what profession would she be?
Okay, who knows who Lyra is? Five people? Yeah! I got someone there. Okay, so I have my company, Geek & Sundry, has a Twitch channel, which is an online gaming streaming platform, if you don't know about Twitch. And we brought